a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in.
There's a cry in my heart for your glory to fall, for your presence to fill every sense. There's a yearning again, a thirst for discipline, a hunger for things that are deeper. Could you take me beyond? Could you carry me through? If I open my heart, could I go there with you? For I've been here before, but I know there's still more. Do I have, if I don't have you, Jesus? What in this life could mean anymore? You are my rock, you are my glory, you are the lifter of my head. What do I have, if I don't have?
And more than ever. just want you and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do.
to see the light.
Put my trust in you alone, and I will not be.
Good morning. How are you doing? I pray and hope that you are all doing well. Did you know that with all this thing that is happening about the pandemic, still 13% of Americans doesn't believe that COVID-19, the coronavirus, is existing. They think it is a hoax. 13% of Americans. And 1 in 20 British adults believe that the Holocaust did not happen. That was 75 years after it happened in 1941 to 1945, when 6 million Jews were murdered. Sometimes it takes an eyewitness to convince people of what really happened. Stephen Frank is a survivor of the Holocaust, and he said the only way to fight this denial is with the truth. He said, "I tell people what happened, what I saw, what I experienced." Our text this morning is from 1 John 1, verse 1 to 4. And John is also an eyewitness, and he is testifying to the truth in these passages that we're going to study. And I want you to go to 1 John chapter 1, verse 1 to 4. We will read it together. "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at, and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared, we have seen it, and testify to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us, and our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy complete." Dear Father in heaven, we come into your presence, praising you, Lord. We want to exalt your name, Lord. With the study of your word, we pray, Lord, that you will be with us, that your Holy Spirit will guide us and teach us. We pray that you will be glorified and you alone. Help us, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Eyewitness. The Apostle John is also an eyewitness. 70 years after the death, resurrection, and ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ, a heretic teaching was already creeping in the church. The teaching that Jesus is not fully divine and not fully human. This teaching is called Gnosticism. The primary teaching of Gnosticism is spirit is good, matter is evil. Human is matter, therefore human is evil. Then human cannot be God. It is a denial that Jesus is not God. If he is fully human, then he cannot be God. John wrote this letter to tell people what they heard, what they have seen with their eyes, what they have touched with their own hands concerning Jesus, the Word of Life. Gnosticism is a dangerous heresy in the first and second century. And even today in our own time, there are people who are saying that Jesus is just a man and not God. Jesus is not God, he's just a man. But the Bible clearly teaches that God is the only Savior. Only God can save. In Hosea chapter 13, verse 4, in Isaiah 43, verse 11, Isaiah 45, verse 21, God said, apart from him, there is no Savior. Only God can save. If Jesus is not God, he cannot save. He is not a Savior. That's why it is very important for us to be assured that Jesus is God. That Jesus is God. If Jesus is not God, then he is not a Savior. If he is not a Savior, then you and me are not saved. Even though we trusted Jesus as our Lord and Savior, if he is not God, then we are still lost, because only God can save. The divinity of Jesus. Our text in 1 John, verse 1 says, that which was from the beginning. John was saying his subject, the Word of Life, the one they proclaim, not only him, he said we. The one they proclaim, he said, was from the beginning. From the beginning. What beginning? You know, there was a time in the beginning before our time began, before our clock started clicking. There was time in the beginning, in eternity past, before creation, before anything was created. There was time in the beginning when there was nothing exists but God. If you go to Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, the first verse says, in the beginning, God. In the beginning, God created. Before he created anything, God was there already. He is a self-existing God. In the beginning, God. The only thing exists before anything was created was God. There was time in eternity past that the only thing that exists is God. I want you to go to John chapter 1, the book of John, Gospel of John chapter 1, and we will read verse 1 and 2. Verse 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 2, he was with God in the beginning. See, the Word was with God in the beginning. The Word is God. The Word was God. This is the Word of Life. This is Jesus Himself. He was with God in the beginning, when there was nothing else that exists except God. The Lord, the Word of Life, was there. The Word of God was there because He is God. And if you go to verse 14, it tells us that the Word became flesh. Who is this? Only Jesus. The Word that became flesh is the Lord Jesus Christ. And John says, He made His dwelling among us. John is testifying that Jesus was with them. He said, We have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father. Jesus came from the Father. Before He became man, He was God and with the Father in the beginning. He was with God in the beginning, in the time that there was nothing else that exists but God. Jesus was there because He Himself is God. And that is what verse 18 of John chapter 1 is telling us. I will read verse 18. No one has ever seen God but the one and only Son, who is Himself God. The one and only Son, Jesus, who is Himself God. Jesus Himself is God. He is God. And He was with God in the beginning. In the beginning, before anything was created. Because Jesus is God. Jesus is God. Going back to our text in 1 John, let us read verse 2. The life appeared. We have seen it and testified to it. And we proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and has appeared to us. Who are they proclaiming? The eternal life, the Word of Life. The life appeared, Jesus appeared. They have seen it, they testify to it, and they proclaim to you, to them, to us, the eternal life. I like this verse because it makes verse 1 more clear that Jesus is from the beginning. Because some teachers, some believers, they think that the beginning in 1 John chapter 1 is not the same beginning in Genesis 1 and John chapter 1. Some said that this beginning may be the beginning of the gospel. But that doesn't matter anymore. Verse 2 tells us that Jesus is eternal. If He is eternal, He exists when there was nothing else exists. If He is eternal, He was with God in the beginning. In the beginning, before anything else was created. Because He is eternal, He is God. Jesus is eternally God. Now that Jesus, we know, is eternal, we know He was there in the beginning, He was there when no one else exists but God. We know that He is God. Therefore, Jesus is a Savior. He is a Savior. Because God said, the only Savior is God. Apart from God, there is no Savior. Jesus is God. Jesus is our Savior. Now, we are assured of our salvation because our Savior is God eternal. Jesus is eternally God. John was an eyewitness. He was at the transfiguration with Peter and James. He was there and he heard God said, "This is my son whom I love." He was there and he heard that. He was there when Jesus rebuked the storm. He was a witness. The wind and the waves obey him. Only God can do that. When Jesus opened the eye of a man born blind, John was there. When Jesus raised the daughter of Jairus from the dead, John was there. He was an eyewitness. Jesus is fully God. He is fully divine. He is an eternal God. But is He fully human? Is he fully human? Some of us may say that doesn't matter anymore because as long as He is God, then He is a Savior. Then if we trust in Him as our Lord and Savior, then we are saved. But it's not like that. One of the heresy in the time of the apostle in the first and second century is Docetism. This is a branch of Gnosticism that teaches that Jesus had no human body. His death and suffering on the cross were apparent rather than real. They were saying that He only appeared to be human but without human substance. No physical reality. He is just a phantom, a mirage. But John, in 2 John verse 7, he said, "Those who do not acknowledge Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh are deceivers and antichrist." Those who do not acknowledge that Jesus came in the flesh are the deceivers and the antichrist. Why is it that the humanity of Jesus Christ is so important? It is important because if Jesus did not become a human, if He did not become man in the incarnation, then He did not die on the cross. He did not pay our sin debt. Because if He is not human, He cannot die. God cannot die. That's why He became man. Then He did die on the cross. He could die on the cross because He was a man. If Jesus is not a man, then you are still in your sin. He did not pay for your sin. You are still a condemned sinner. You and I are still a condemned sinner. If Jesus was not able to pay our sin debt on the cross, because if He was not a man, He could not die. So he has to be man, fully human. And that is why there was incarnation. That's why God became man. That's why Jesus became man. That's why he came in the flesh. That is the reason for it. And John said, they are the witness. They can testify to it, that Jesus is fully human. In our text, in verse 1, John said, our hand have touched him. Our hand have touched him. We did not only seen him with our eyes, we did not only heard him with our ears, but we were able to touch him. They were able to touch him because Jesus has a human body. He has physical reality. They have touched him with their own hands. When Pilate had Jesus' flag, his body was beaten. If Jesus has no physical body, he cannot be beaten. He cannot be flagged. At the cross, Jesus was nailed on the cross. How can they nail him if he has no physical body? Jesus was nailed on the cross because he has physical body. They were able to nail him. His side was pierced with a spear at the cross. He has a body and a side where they pierce him. At the burial of Jesus, Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus asked Pilate for permission to take away Jesus' body. And they took away the body of Christ. They took his body away. If he has no body, if he is just a phantom and just an appearance with no human substance, what is that body that they took away? That is a real body. That's why they were able to take his body away. Then Joseph and Nicodemus wrap his body with the spices in a strip of linen. They wrap his body, the physical body of the Lord Jesus Christ. And John was there. He was there. He was the writer of John, the Gospel of John. When Joseph and Nicodemus laid his body in the tomb, John was there. And he said, they laid his body in the tomb. He has a body, a physical body that laid in the tomb, that was laid in the tomb. John is a witness that Jesus is fully human. Jesus was fully human. He died on the cross. He paid for our sin. That is very important, that he is fully human, so that he can die on the cross to pay for our sin. And he did. He died on the cross. He paid for our sin. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Romans chapter 8, verse 1. Jesus is fully God and pulley man. He is pulley God and pulley man. Now, let us read verse 3 of our text. Verse 3. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. I want to stop there for a moment. John says, we proclaim to you what we have seen and heard. For what reason? So that you also may have fellowship with us. This is an invitation for those who are not yet in the fellowship. Those who are not yet believer, you are being invited into this fellowship. This fellowship is not just a social gathering. This fellowship is being a partaker, a partner in the gospel, a partaker in eternal life. If you haven't accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you are being invited to believe that Jesus is fully God and fully man. He was fully God, he is a Savior. He is fully man and was able to die on the cross to pay for mine and your sin. Jesus, the God-man, he is fully God and fully man. Accept him as your Lord and Savior, and you will be saved. And you will enter into the fellowship of the believer. And the second part of this verse says, and our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. Our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. The fellowship of the believer is not just a fellowship of those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. This is a fellowship with the Father and the Son. This is a fellowship with God the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. If you are a believer, I hope you love having fellowship with your brothers and sisters, because having a fellowship with the brothers and sisters in the Lord is having a fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ and God the Father himself. If you fellowship, it will make you a strong believer. It helps when you are in trial, when you are in trouble, you have someone to help you to carry your burden. Believers, brothers and sisters, fellowship with your brother and sister, because this fellowship brings joy, and this fellowship is with the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus is God, fully God. Jesus is man, fully man. And he wants us to fellowship with him, with our fellow brothers and sisters. Brothers and sisters, I hope that you will love fellowshipping with your brothers and sister. Father, we praise you and thank you for the study of your word, for the preaching of your word. May you be glorified. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
I've always heard there is a land beyond the mortal dreams of
where every tear will be left behind. But it must be another time. Oh,
there'll be an everlasting light shining your purest holy white,
and every fear will be erased. But it must be another place. Oh, another time. Oh,
and though I put my trust in Christ and felt His Spirit move in my life,
I know it's truly just a taste of His glory in another place.
Payuay erkaw tulosan susunod misan pamati an Apo Hesu Kristo. Good day to all of you, brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ.
I am Johnny Makad. I belong to the Botbot tribe in the province of Kalinga in northern part of the Philippines.
I'm Orfa Sabiniano Makad from Laguna province, the southern Tagalog region. At present, we are living here at the compound of New Tribe School of Missions, Dinalupihan, Bataan. We transferred here in May 2015 from our mission station in Abra province. So we are already in our sixth year of ministry here at NTSM. NTSM is the training arm of New Tribes Missions of the Philippines. God led us to this organization so that we could fulfill our desire and His call for us to be missionaries to the unreached tribal people groups.
The Lord gave us the privilege to be involved in the training of would-be missionaries to the different tribal or ethnic group in the Philippines and to other countries of Asia. To help equip missionary students, I am teaching the subject building on from foundation or chronological Bible teaching method, Romans, life of Christ, cult, and world religions. To ignite the students' passion for the lost, we go out every Sunday to different outreaches to teach God's word. Aside from teaching, we are serving as full-time staff. I am assigned as the school administrator, overseeing the training every day, facilitating all meetings and representing the school to government offices. I am also working as a maintenance and facilities development coordinator, as well as janitor.
Same with my husband, I am teaching three subjects every school year. So I'm teaching literacy, partnership development, stress and conflict management. With regards to office work, I write the school's prayer letter or ministry update and function as a secretary. I also handle the medical program of the school. For more than 5 decades, the training of the missionary students has been on a stay-in basis, physically close to each other, face-to-face classes, mentoring by example. Suddenly, it was disrupted by the COVID-19 pandemic. But God has already prepared the high technology needed for such a time as this. So we shifted to online training, equipping through virtual classes. And this is in line with God's message to us.
To continue fulfilling the Great Commission to go and make disciples of all nations is God's message to us in the midst of the pandemic crisis. As long as we have the opportunity to equip would-be missionaries who will advance God's kingdom, we will continue to build up and strengthen the young frontliners in missions, calling all the upliners or partners in the ministry for backup. He will be with us, knowing that God is faithful to His promises is enough to encourage us and rekindle the passions for the unreached people groups.
For our prayer request, kindly pray that our family, together with our co-staff and all missionary students, will continue to grow in our knowledge of God and love for the Lord Jesus, so that we will all live and serve Him for His glory. Pray also for good health, especially for COVID-free training and COVID-free mentors and missionary students. Also for strong internet signal in this area and in the locations where our students are studying online, especially in Palawan.
Brothers and sisters in Christ of Mississauga Family Baptist Church, thank you for your faithful partnership with us in serving the Lord all these years. Thank you for your prayers, encouragement, financial gifts, and friendship. You are to us a tangible expressions of God's love and faithfulness.
Thank you very much, brothers and sisters in Christ.
Let us give God the glory for today's worship celebration. And thank you everyone for joining with us Sunday after Sunday. And thank you Pastor Deo for the wonderful message. And thank you to our worship team. And also today, thank God for the wonderful testimony of Pastor Johnny and Sister Orpa Makad a couple of Fridays when he sent it to me, this video. I didn't realize that will be the last time that I will talk to him. That life is very short. I was so surprised, speechless last Tuesday when I heard about this news. Yes, he's dead. What the Bible says in Hebrews 11:4. Yes, he is dead. But he can still speak. A lot of people minister by him. And thank God for his life, Pastor Johnny Manfred. And let us continue to pray for Sister Orpa and their two kids. Let's pray for God's comfort and peace be upon them. And also continue to pray for each one of us. How many pastors whom I knew who passed away this year? Just this year is about 5 pastors. Continue to pray for the Lord's workers. Pastor Johnny is a faithful servant, an army of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And let us come to the Lord in prayer. Our dear God and Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you for today's worship. Indeed, Lord, our heart was so burdened because of what happened to Pastor Johnny Makad. But we thank you for his life. Thank you, Father, for using him for many years in the ministry, especially in Mountain Province. I pray, God, that you will bless his ministry, even though he is gone in this world, that someone who will replace him, oh God, all the works that he left. I pray also for Sister Orpa and their two kids, oh Lord. May you continue to comfort me upon them and their family, oh Lord, and your provisions, oh God, financially. And also, Lord, today, we are so thankful, especially in the Philippines, even those several typhoons, oh Lord, especially last Tuesday and Wednesday, thank God, and we thank you for your protection to our loved ones. And I pray for those who are still affected of this calamity. May you continue to comfort them and be with them, especially for all the believers. And today, Lord, we praise you. And we thank you, O God, may your continuous protection be upon your people, even in our church community. May your daily provision, O God, and keep us away from any harm. Thank you, Father God. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor power, nor heights, nor depths, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen and amen. Thank you so much again for joining with us. See you next Sunday, and God bless you all.
You go before I know that you've even gone to win my war. You come back with the head of my enemy. You come back and you call it my victory. Oh, 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 you go before I know that you've even gone to win my war. Your love becomes my greatest defense. It leads me from the dry wilderness, and all I did was pray. And all I did was worship. All I did was bow down. All I did was stay still. And hallelujah, you have saved me. So much better. Heart can seek to find your truth. Your mercy is the shade I'm living in, and you restore my faith and hope again. And all I did was praise, and all I did was worship. All I did was bow down. Oh, and all I did was stay still. Oh, and hallelujah, you have saved me. So much better this way.
and all I did was praise. All I need to do is worship. Lord, I will just bow down. I'm just gonna stay still.